Most people think of Cleveland when they think of the history of rock and roll, but Cincinnati has its own part of the story. And luckily for us, we have in the studio today reference librarian Brian Powers, and you're going to tell us how Cincinnati is connected to that history.
Yep.
Tell us how we in Cincinnati can be proud to be part of the history of rock and roll.
Well, you know, I worked with a group of guys over the years, tried to promote the King Records history. People, part of a thing called King Studios, which is a project to sort of develop a museum or some sort of music center on King. And, you know, one of the people we met was Terry Stewart, the president of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. This was back in 2009 when we met with him. We had lunch and stuff, and we were talking about the whole King Records because he's a big fan of King Records, understand its importance to music history, particularly rock and roll history, too. And that we were discussing stuff, and he said, well, you know, King Records, it's really the lost history of rock and roll. And that's something we've kind of always used to talk about why it's important. And some people sometimes want to try and say that Cincinnati was, you know, the birthplace of rock and roll. That's always something people argue about, and I'm not going to get into that. But I think we have a little bit of claim to why we're a highly influential record label, King Records, in Cincinnati. How that was part of how rock and roll developed. You know, it's a big influence, a lot of those artists. And a lot of these artists you may not know. I mean, most people have heard of James Brown, but almost a lot of the other artists you won't know. But they have been recognized by a lot of different Hall of Fames, not just the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but the Country Hall of Fame and the Bluegrass Hall of Fame and the Gospel Hall of Fame and the Doo-Wop Hall of Fame. A lot of Hall of Fames in America. So it really is like a true American music at King Records, which was here in Cincinnati. In Evanston, which is near Xavier University.
So a lot of people think of rock and roll in the 50s, but the history of King Records goes back to the 40s.
That's right. King Records was started by a gentleman named Sid Nathan, who was a gentleman who was born in the West End when there was a large Jewish population. Most people think of the West End as an African-American community, which is true. It became solely African-American starting probably around a little before World War I, but it had a lot of Jewish population there. And Sid was born in the West End, but he grew up in Price Hill. And he started King Records in 1943. He was quite a character. He had a lot of different jobs and occupations before he got into owning a record label. He used to be a wrestling promoter, used to run a pawn shop. He ran a jewelry store, used to sell real estate, did all sorts of stuff in the 20s and 30s. And then he opened a record shop. There's a story on how he got involved with records. His brother-in-law had a photo shop on West 5th Street downtown, and some guy owed him money. And the guy didn't have any money. He was a jukebox operator. This is when jukeboxes were getting really popular. Jukeboxes got really popular in the mid-1930s. And this guy didn't have any money. But he said, I'll tell you what, you know, I bought a bunch of huge 78, these old 78s. You know, back in the day, that's what you had was a 78, which was you had one song on side A and another song on side B. And the speed was 78. And that was pretty much the format that people listened to music, you know, particularly in the 30s and the 40s. That changed in the 50s with the 45 and then the albums and stuff. But anyways, this guy was a jukebox operator, and he said, well, I'll tell you what, I give you a bunch of these used records, and they'll sell. And so it was like, well, I don't know. But they put it out on the store, and it sold like hotcakes. I mean, he made his money back like that. And that's where he got the idea. It's like, you know, maybe I should get into a little selling more records. So that's what he did, is he opened a used record shop, his own record shop, in the West End on Central Avenue, which is exactly the spot where the new soccer stadium is being built. That's exactly where his shop was. He opened it in 1940, and he sold, you know, it's interesting why he picked that spot. It was on Central Avenue, because on one side you had the West End, which was primarily African American, but then on the other side you had Over the Rhine, which at that time, in the early 40s, had become Appalachian. A lot of people had migrated from the South, from Appalachia into Over the Rhine. A lot of people, African Americans from the South, came and settled in the West End. So he was sort of selling records to black people and to Appalachian people. And so that's kind of what King ended up becoming, was a record label that sort of marketed to those two different populations. And so that's why it was recording country music and R&B music starting in the 40s.
That was just making me think about the diverse kinds of musical backgrounds that they needed to cater to from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
So what kind of early bands or musicians were the first ones to become part of that, to serve those populations?
Well, the very first artist to ever record for King, some people may remember this guy, some people may not. I remembered him from Hee Haw, named Grandpa Jones. Grandpa Jones was the very first artist to record for King Records in September of 1943. Grandpa, he was born in Kentucky, and he moved around, actually lived in Akron, Ohio for a while, you know, got into radio. This is the early 40s, so when you're a musician, a lot of people got jobs working for radio stations. So he had worked at different jobs, and here in Cincinnati, we had WLW, which now you think of as big talk radio, but back in the day, WLW was a big deal. It was called the Nation Station because it was the only radio station in America that had a license from the U.S. government that it could broadcast at 500,000 watts. The closest you could come to, if you're another station, was 50. So they're at 500. And the reason why Pal Crossley, who owned everything, like the Reds and all sorts of stuff, he started WLW. And you know, he pitched this whole idea, we should be broadcast at 500. And that was because we're in the middle of the country and we could reach greater parts of the country, all throughout America, and you could. You know, Chet Atkins grew up in North Carolina, and when he was listening to WLW, he would tune into something called the Boone County Jamboree in the late 30s. And on there was Grandpa Jones and another guy named Merle Travis. And Merle Travis was a direct influence on Chet Atkins. Chet Atkins wanted to play like Merle Travis, and he did. That was his idol. But that's how he got introduced to Merle Travis, because he was listening to WLW, because he could pick it up in Carolina. Later, Chet Atkins actually worked for WLW back in 45, 46, before he ended up going down to Nashville. But the other guy that was on the very first session of Grandpa Jones was Merle Travis. So on the very first recording is a song written by Grandpa Jones, and Merle Travis is playing the guitar.
It's raining here this morning. As I sit in jail and hang my head in shame, with a smile I try to greet each early dawning, though they've given me a number for my name.
But both those gentlemen were both inducted into the Country Hall of Fame later on in the 1970s.
So we see Cincinnati's impact on music, and we're talking about, well, initially we're talking about King Records and the record studio and who did they record, but really Cincinnati has an impact that reached much further than we can see now. We don't necessarily think of it. In North Carolina, people were getting influenced by what's happening here in Cincinnati.
That's WLW, you're talking about broadcasting, but when King started around, you know, King was very aggressive. It was a very unique operation. It was an independent record label, and what that means, there were really only three major record labels in this time period. You know, they were the big ones. There was RCA, and there was Decca, and so Sid comes along. Now, there were some small record labels. He wasn't the first independent small record label, but what Sid did that was different, two things that he did that were different. He built his own record plant, okay? If you had a small record label, you're an independent guy in LA or something like that, you wanted to start a record label, you know, you would have to go find some guy to make your record for you, okay? Well, Sid didn't have to do that. He made his own records. He actually made everything, had a studio, made the records there. But the other real unique thing about an independent record label that he had was that he distributed his own product. Usually, if you're an independent label, you had to go to some guy in Chicago who's going to hook you up with some guy in Detroit who's going to hook you up with this, and then get your records in these stores. Sid didn't want to deal with that. He was a control freak. And so what he did is he just created his own distributing system. And so he distributed his own product, and it went out to jukeboxes all around the U.S., in record stores, on the radio. So he was that was a very unique operation, and that's why by the late 40s, by 49, it was the largest independent record label in America. It was the sixth largest record label in America, but it was the largest of the independent labels. He was doing R&B, and he was doing country at the same time, and he had number one hits with those in those markets in the late 40s. And then he actually got into pop music. And one of the early people that when he started to get into the pop field was Betty Clooney, who's Rosemary Clooney's sister, and she had one or two hits on that. But another guy who he wasn't really successful in the pop field, because that was a very hard market to get into. But Sid did try to do that. But he had Steve Lawrence, who became very famous later on with Edie Gourmet. He did his very first recording for King when he was 16 years old. So King was doing all that. Later on, they got into jazz, they got into bluegrass, you know, and then later on you get into James Brown. You get into like that's in the 60s when Basie James Brown invents funk music. Why he's at King Records. You know, there's a quote I found where he said, like, you know, in the R&B in the country fields, I don't take my hat off to anybody. I mean, that was in 49. You know, Nashville hadn't quite got it together yet. It wasn't the music center. But by 54, though, that's when all the major labels started moving and having studios and having record labels based in Nashville. So by 54, that starts happening in the country thing. So Sid couldn't compete with that. So that's why he got into doing bluegrass. He brought in the Stanley Brothers, Reno and Smiley, who are another important bluegrass group that recorded for King. They're both in the Bluegrass Hall of Fame. So he kind of switched when he couldn't compete, you know, one-on-one with Nashville, then he just would find other markets to get into. My number one favorite King Records artist is a guy named, you probably guys have never heard of him, but his name is Moon Mulligan. He was from East Texas, and he started recording for King in 1946, so he was an early artist for them. He was a major influence on Jerry Lee Lewis. I had tracked down a couple people who knew Moon back in the day, and he was quite a character. You know, he was kind of a fun-loving guy, drank maybe a little too much and stuff, but he was amazing piano player. He actually was on the Grand Ole Opry. He was a Grand Ole Opry probably from 1951 to about 1958, and if you hear him, you can hear Jerry Lee Lewis. You know, but what I love about what he was doing was he loved R&B music. So before Elvis, I mean, we're talking 4 years before Elvis broke, here's a white dude who's covering black music and having black musicians play on his songs at King Records. He got the, he was working with Henry Glover, who was a producer at King Records, who was an African-American man, and they wrote a couple songs together. So, I mean, Moon wasn't afraid to be produced by a black guy, and he actually really preferred to play with black musicians, you know. So his stuff's kind of rock before rock and roll was around. It's kind of boogie woogie East Texas, because he played in a lot of a lot of rough bars, and he knew how to get the crowd going and stuff. So I love him. I love Little Willie John, who was a big artist for King in the starting in 56 to until he died. In the late 60s, and he was a little guy. That's why he's called Little Willie Johnny from Detroit, and big influence on James Brown. When Little Willie John died, James Brown did a whole album, a tribute album to Little Willie John, and Little Willie John finally got into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, like, maybe 2006, I think, you know, many years after he died. He's the very first guy to record Fever.
Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care. When you put your arms around me, I get a feeling that's so hard to bear. You give me fever.
Which was pretty cool. King did that a lot. There were a lot of songs that came out of King that were recorded at King before other people did more famous versions. Fever being Little Willie John did that first, but then later on other people did it. Kansas City, you know, I always think of the Beatles doing that, but that was first done by Little Willie Willifield, I think was his name was. I'm a little rusty on that guy's name.
Kansas City, here I come. They got a crazy way of loving there, and I'm gonna get me some.
Train Kept a Rollin', which you hear Aerosmith do that on classic rock stations. That was first done by Tiny Bradshaw.
Yes, the train kept rolling
all night long.
Yeah, the train kept rolling
all night long.
Whoa, the train kept rolling
all night long.
Tiny Bradshaw is actually buried here in town over in Price Hill in an African American cemetery over there. There's a few other artists. Bonnie Lou, who was popular here on the Midwestern Hayride, she did Seven Lonely Days, which I always thought of as a Patsy Cline song, but she was the one that did do a first of a country version of it, and then Patsy Cline covered her version later on. Good Rockin' Tonight, which I always think is an Elvis song out of Memphis, was actually first recorded here in Cincinnati by Wynonie Harris in 1947. Number one hit for King, and the R&B hit in 1948. So that was about 7 years before Elvis recorded it.
It is really interesting to hear how many of the songs that we think we know the original version of actually have their birthplace in Cincinnati.
Right.
With people we've never looked up before, we haven't heard their version, but a lot of our favorite songs come from here, and it's neat to have that local connection to these parts of music history that means they're our neighborhood history too.
Right.
I really enjoy that. What are some of the other musicians that you really like to let people know about?
Well, let's see. I think the Delmore Brothers, who also were very early artists for King, they came here to Cincinnati and recorded, they were performers on WLW. And they were the second artists, really, to record for King after Merle Travis and Grand Paul Jones. Very important guys. Two brothers who were from Alabama. They're in the Country Hall of Fame. But what they did was they really, I wouldn't say they invented it. Some people say they invented it. Other people say they just made it, you know, they're known for it. But what's called a guitar boogie, which is precursor to rockabilly. If you hear it, it's like the early, it's like basically they've kind of gone electric. They're kind of taking R&B music and blending it with country music. Also another brother group, there were a lot of brother groups back in the 40s and 50s in the country, but there were York Brothers, who are like a precursor to the Everly Brothers. And Everly Brothers used to cover some of their tunes, the York Brothers. People have never heard of them. But there were another group that was country that was also into recovering R&B groups. I mean, at King, that was an interesting thing what King did. They actually had a business policy starting about 49, from 49 to about 53. They basically, if they had a hit with an R&B group at King, which means African American, they would have one of their country artists do it. And if a country artist had a hit, then they would have an R&B artist cover it. Like Whiny Harris covered Hank Penny's Bloodshot Eyes, which was a big hit for Hank Penny on the country label. So, you know, Sid Nathan was like, oh, he was a guy who apparently didn't see black or white. All he saw was green. So he thought, hey, you know, if it's a hit in this market, it should transfer over here. And a lot of times he was right on. He would have a hit, you know. You know, they had 300 people working at the plant over there in Evanston, you know, making records. I mean, they had their own marketing department. They had an art department. They had they had their own truck system, you know. They had everything there. It was like this all under one roof thing, right? So he had a lot of employees that had hit payroll, right? So I mean, this was an idea that he had. Like, if you had copyright on one song, and then if you had somebody else cover that, that's in your same label, you double your money basically. So that was something that he was doing from 49 until the early 50s. For about 3 or 4 years, Elvis comes along, but you know, Elvis isn't the first white guy to record, you know, black music. It was happening here in Cincinnati like 5 years before he came along. And you know, King, I failed to mention, had a policy in 1947 where it was basically a colorblind hire policy. They integrated the workforce, and that was one of the a very early company here in Cincinnati. It really wasn't happening a whole lot at that time. So King had this. For the time, a quite innovative policy of hiring black people and putting them in positions of like manager positions and things like that, which was actually a great idea, because what they would do is they would record sessions, they could print them right away, and then they would do little test things with the staff there. They would play records like, what do you think? Does it sound like a hit? And then they would know that they would hit when the Delmore Brothers recorded Blue Stay Away With Me in 1949. That was co-written by Henry Glover, who's African-American, and Henry had produced it. But the riff of that song was an R&B song, but the Delmores kind of took the lyrics and they made it into sort of a countrified R&B thing. It was a big hit. It's been covered over 100 times, Blue Stay Away From Me. But what they did is when they recorded that, they would play it all around the people, the workforce that were working in the plants, and they would have people like listen to it. And they knew they had a hit when people were like, wow, what is that? And so that's another kind of cool thing about King.
It's neat because it's a window, we've been talking about music history, but it's also a window into Cincinnati's business history.
Yeah.
And some really significant things happening in Cincinnati's business world, that you had a workforce that employed all different kinds of people. Mm-hmm. You also had the musicians playing together on the same mm-hmm. album, the songwriters working together on the same album.
Yep.
And that's really significant.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's
a cool story. It's a cool thing.
It really is. And it's part of our Cincinnati history. And yeah. I feel like it's important that we know this. This happened where we live.
Yep. We have some books. We can talk about this. I don't know if this is the time to talk about, but we do have books at the library if you want to read more about King Records. There are several books out. You know, which really didn't start happening until about 10 years ago. There wasn't anything to really read on King, but there are several books out there. Probably the definitive book to read is John Harley Fox's book, which came out in 2009. John used to live here. He lives out in California now. But he managed to track down a lot of these guys, like Grandpa Jones, and interview them before they passed away. So his book's pretty good. It covers all the genres of music and stuff. I mean, for me, I'm not from Cincinnati. I moved here from Virginia in 95. And, you know, I moved here. I love music. And I heard James Brown had recorded here. And I had never heard of King Records in my life, you know. But I was interested in King. I mean, I was interested in James Brown. But I had the impression that James Brown had just recorded a little bit here and then he moved on. But then when you actually look into all this, which I did, you know, back in 2008 when I was the music librarian at the main library, I discovered that actually all these big James Brown hits were pretty much all recorded at King, like, you know, Papa's Got a Brand New Bag, you know, This is the Man's World, Cold Sweat, and all these huge number one hits that he had in the late 60s were all recorded at King. And he was on King for about 16 years. And but that's what I was interested in. But then when you start researching it, then you discover all this other music that was recorded here and all these other artists, you know, and I thought that was pretty cool. So I made sure at the library that we have all these CDs of all these different artists that you never heard of, York Brothers, Moon Mulligan, you know, Little Willie John, all these guys, you know, I have, they're available to check out at the library. If you don't want to go downtown, you can have them sent to your local branch. Before we moved on to something else, I just wanted to say that there are a couple other books other than John Fox's book. There's Randy McNutt, who's a local writer, who's written a lot about Ohio history and a lot of music history too. And John put a book out on Arcadia Publishing. Arcadia Publishing are these books that are mostly photos. And John, and I'm sorry, Randy has been, you know, he's been researching King for 40 years. And so he's accumulated a lot of photos. So this is a great book too, because it's mostly photos, which is kind of cool. But he has captions and things like that. So that's a great book to read. But, you know, Randy has written a lot of books. He's written about the rockabilly stuff that was recorded, not just here at King in Cincinnati, but there were other labels in Cincinnati that recorded rockabilly. And so he's got a book about rockabilly. He's got one called Guitar Town, which has a chapter on King, but there's other stuff about Ohio history. So Randy McNutt, I know you can't go wrong with getting any of his books. And also Darren Blaze, who owns Shake It Records here in Cincinnati. He didn't write a book. I turned something he wrote into a book for him with his blessings. Darren had written a paper when he was in college about King Records. And it was a pretty long paper, all about the history of King. And so I got his permission for me to turn that into a book with some photos and stuff. And that's not available for sale, but you can check out copies at the library of Darren Blaze's book on King Records. So there's three main books you can get on King, and there's some other stuff too.
And the key is the library is a really good resource to find out all of this.
That's right.
That's where you find it all, through the Hamilton County Public Library.
Make it even easier. We have a King Records section on the library's website. You can go there and it'll take you to all these books and CDs that we're talking about.
So, oh, even better.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. So we've talked about a lot of musicians that folks may not be familiar with the exception of James Brown, which mm-hmm. I think people are familiar with. But if they don't realize that some of these songs are part of their modern popular culture and not just something that lives in the past, what are some of the places people might have heard some of this today?
Well, we're just talking about rockabilly, and one of the guys I love is Charlie Feathers. He was a rockabilly guy. He was from Memphis, knew Elvis and stuff. Elvis did one of his songs, but he came to Cincinnati and recorded for King, and he's got some amazing songs if you like rockabilly. And one of those songs Quentin Tarantino must like, because it's on the Kill Bill movie. If you watch Kill Bill, all of a sudden you'll hear Charlie Feathers, and there's a song that he recorded here in Cincinnati. Another song is, there was a local group here, doo-wop group. King Records did a lot of doo-wop music in the 50s. Otis Williams and the Charms, who were from Withrow High School, and they had a big number one hit in 53, Hearts of Stone. And if you watch the beginning of Goodfellas, Martin Scorsese film, there's a part where he's talking about the main guy is talking about being a teenager, and you will hear Hearts of Stone in this one scene. And so you will hear that a lot. Bonnie Lou, who was popular here in Cincinnati, one of her songs that she did for King, I can't think of what it is, but I forget what movie, but hers has been used for TV shows, TV movies, and things like that.
That's fantastic, because we know that Cincinnati is really working to be part of the movie industry.
Right.
And that's another way that our history is part of the movie industry. Mm-hmm. Now, King's Records is no more. How did its time period wind up running out?
Well, I mean, one of the main person that kind of kept King going, I mean, a lot of people, it was a big operation, but the main dude was Sid Nathan, the owner, the guy who started it. He had a lot of family members who bankrolled him, but he was the push behind it. But the problem with Sid is that, you know, he was not a health nut by any means. If you saw him, he was pretty overweight, smoked cigars constantly and stuff. And he started having a heart problem, serious health issues in the late 50s and into the early 60s. And actually throughout the, you know, he was almost going to sell the label and by 63, 64, because his health was getting so bad. I mean, he had a brother who was a heart specialist in Miami, and he had to spend half the year in Miami with his brother. His brother was always looking at him, trying to get him to eat right and all this stuff. And so there's a lot of pressure in the family for him to, you know, give up the thing, but I think he had it in his blood. So he didn't really want to sell. And then what happened is James Brown had Papa Got a Brand New Bag happens. And then basically that's what keeps King Records going through the 60s. And pretty much, you know, from 65 up until it ended in Cincinnati in 71, which pretty much, it was a James Brown. And a lot of people think James Brown owned the label. At one point, his face even appears on the record label. But it was still, he didn't own it, but he was the moneymaker. And he had creative control. So all those big hits he had, I mean, he basically controlled everything. But then Sid died in 68. And then it kept going with other guys who had worked for King under Sid. They sort of took it over. And they were having huge hits with James Brown. But you can't really have a record label just with one artist. It just doesn't. You have to diversify. That's how it works. And I guess they realized after a point it just wasn't going to work. So they eventually, what they did was in 71, they sold James Brown's record contract to a different label, Polydor Records. And then they basically sold everything in the building, all the stuff that made the records, that all got sold and all that at auction. And a lot of the stereo, a lot of the stuff that was in the studio, all that recording stuff ended up going down to Starday Records in Nashville. And then it tried to continue on as King started, tried to continue on for a year or so after Nashville, and then it petered out. And eventually it was sold to Gusto Records in 75, the catalog. And basically it's been Gusto Records, which is in Nashville, has been putting out reissues, and they license things, and they basically own the copyright, and they own the trademark of the company and stuff.
So if anyone's going to re-release any of these great early songs that you talked about, it's going to come through them.
Yeah, and actually there are, you know, what's really, where King Records is very popular is in Europe. I mean, it's big in England. They have these guys who are into, you know, DJs, British, they're into soul music, obscure soul music, and they love King Records, and they want the 45s. But there's labels, there's an English label that has the licensing from Gusto to put out King stuff. So a lot of the stuff that we bought for the library were actually imports from UK labels, UK and then Spain, pretty big in Europe. Because, you know, Europeans, they really love that old American, you know, especially R&B music they love. But they also love the, they called hillbilly back in the day, hillbilly music, you know, honky-tonk music. And King had a lot of that recording, too. I think another thing that King and Cincinnati has a good claim to fame, or a good claim on, it's the birthplace of funk music. And that's because of James Brown. And basically, James Brown, not me, it's other people, music historians, who have higher, bigger clout than me, you know, say that he's the guy who invented funk music. And that's, and one of the songs that they say is the very first funk song, because other people would say it might be Sly Family Stone, but it would be James Brown because he recorded Cold Sweat here in Cincinnati in 1967. And then after that, James Brown even says that his music changed. And that's was funk music. And then you have Bootsy Collins, who's here from Cincinnati. We all know Bootsy. Well, he loves the funk. And where did he learn funk music? Is when he started playing with James Brown here at King Records. That's where he got his start, was at King Records as a session player. Then became James Brown's bass player. And that's where funk music, I mean, I think that's pretty cool, you know? And that music that James Brown had recorded in the late 60s here in Cincinnati, that's been a major, major influence on rap music and hip hop. I mean, all that sampling that's been done, especially in the 80s, and it still continues now. I mean, it was from music that he recorded for King Records.
So we see Cincinnati and King Records influences on R&B, on country, on funk, on rap, on pop music. Mm-hmm. So we can see all that out in our local city. So Cleveland, take that. We've got a lot of that in Cincinnati.
And you know, the Rock Hall has been very, very supportive of King. They really have. So I think they would love for us to do more stuff on King Records here in town, because they've been very supportive. I've been up there a couple times for a couple programs and things, and they've actually been here for different conferences, and I've been invited to be part on some panel discussions and things like that. So they make more of an effort. I mean, because, you know, for the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, there were about 14 people who recorded for King Records who've been inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
It sounds like we've covered just a sampling of some of the stories that come out of King's Records, so I think folks will need to find those books and find that section of the library website that's just about King's Records. They can find those references, find those CDs in the collection, the library. And I want to thank you very much for coming in to tell some of those stories.
Well, thanks for having me. Thanks for inviting me. It was great chatting with you.
And thank you for watching. Hope you learned a lot about one part of the music history of Cincinnati. And I hope you now are inspired to go look up more of those stories from King Records.